unto wife, the heart leaves love to behold this golden day.
Pardon me, is everybody there? Because if everybody's there, I'd like to thank you all for coming to the wedding, and I appreciate you going even more. I mean, you must have liked the better things to do. Not a word of it to Paul. Remember, Paul, you know the man I'm going to marry, but I'm not, because I wouldn't ruin anyone as wonderful as he is. Thank you all for the gifts and the flowers. Thank you all. Now it's back to the showers. Don't tell Paul, but I'm not getting married today. Listen, everybody, look, I don't know what you're waiting for. A wedding, what's a wedding? It's a prehistoric ritual where everybody promises fidelity forever, which is maybe the most horrifying word I've heard, which is followed by a honeymoon. Well, suddenly he'll realize he's saddled with a nut and want to kill me, which he should. Thanks a bunch, but I'm not getting married. Go have lunch, because I'm not getting married. You've been grand, but I'm not getting married. Don't just stand there. I'm not getting married. And don't tell Paul that I'm not getting married today. Go, can't you go? Why is nobody listening? Goodbye, go and cry at another person's wake. If you're quick for a kick, you could pick up a christening. But please, on my knees, there's a human life at stake. Listen, everybody, I'm afraid you didn't hear. Do you want to see a crazy lady fall apart in front of you? It isn't only Paul who may be ruining his life. You know, we'll both of us be losing our identities. I telephoned my analyst about it, and he said it's the money, but my money I'll be floating in the Hudson with the other garbage, and I'm not well, so I'm not getting married. You've been swell, but I'm not getting married. Clear the hall, because I'm not getting married. And thank you all, but I'm not getting married. And don't tell Paul, but I'm not getting married today.
Bless this bride, totally insane, slipping down the drain. And bless this day in our hearts as it starts to rain. This day is for
everyone. Oh, can't you go? Don't you know? I adore you all, but why must you die like Eliza on the ice? Look for her. Tell you, but I may be coming down with hepatitis, and I think I'm gonna faint. So if you want to see me faint, I'll do it happily. But wouldn't it be funnier to go and watch a funeral? Thank you for the 27 dinner plates, the 37 butter knives, the 47 paper weights, the 57 candles.
One more thing.
I'm not getting married.
Softly said.
I'm not getting married.
With this ring.
I'm not getting married.
Easy wed.
I'm not getting married.
Let us pray.
I'm not getting married.
Let us pray.
I'm not getting married today.
And here she is, Nancy.
Yes, on this beautiful day. Is it nice there?
Finally, you and I have gotten together to do this. How long have we been trying to do this?
I don't know, but I applaud you. You've been so patient and persistent. And thank gosh, it finally happened.
Well, I am thrilled that you're here tonight. We are going to cover all points from Pensacola to Virginia to Oxnard.
Oxnard. Yes, I fondly call it the Channel Island Beach. That sort of is my address, but Oxnard is, it's a weird name, isn't it? But it's beautiful. It's beautiful where I am. I'm on the water.
I have to tell you, I thought, did you know Ray Jessel?
Yes, I met him. Yes.
Yes. Well, Ray Jessel wrote a great song called Oxnard. And the first time that I drove through Oxnard, I said, it's a real place.
It's a real place.
And there you are. You live there. First of all.
And yes, and Johnny Carson used to always say, for God's sake, don't step in the Oxnard. And and when I was doing Too Close for Comfort with Ted Knight, he one day announced that I own property in Oxnard. And we all thought that was the funniest thing. Unfortunately, none of us came up here to see it, you know? My husband played golf for 30 years up here, but he never drove west. He never knew about the beaches, and I mean, it's beautiful where I am.
Gorgeous there. How did you end up in Oxnard?
Well, two things. My husband, my darling Val, wanted to get out of LA. He'd really had it with LA. So we made arrangements to sell our place. And then I couldn't find a place. We were gonna rent for a while. I couldn't find anything. And so I started looking, like everyone does, a little farther. And a couple of things popped up that I went, oh, God, that's a nice house, blah, blah, blah. And we came up here to look, and we stayed. It's hard for me a little bit. I miss being so close to my friends. So we meet halfway or I drive in. But that's getting less and less, you know. And when we were in New York recently, Val and I went for a mini trip just to see all our friends. And at one point, after a show, we were crossing through the Broadway area, which, of course, as you know, is a madhouse. And he said, oh, my God, I can't live like this. I can't live like this. You know, I gave him a shot and I said, we don't.
Well, let me ask you, I mean, it's funny because, you know, Patti LuPone just famously said that she was giving up her equity card.
And I know.
Her reason for giving it all up. She said the madhouse of what that area of New York has turned into. And for those who don't live in the New York City area, it's become like a shopping mall. It's, you know, it's a culmination, in my opinion, of everything wrong with this country. And it's all in a melting pot right there in the center of Times Square. Coming back to New York and having spent so many years doing theater here, what is that experience like coming back and looking at what has changed, not only in the geographic area, but yeah, also in the business itself?
You know, I've been thinking about it a lot because I'm going through my memorabilia, which I'm donating to my college. I never wanted to leave New York. I was so happy there. I had become successful very early on. And, you know, I loved where I lived. And then it came to the point where my manager said, I can't get you a job anymore, even in summer stock, because you're not on television. So he kept saying, you know, you got to do television. And I really had, I mean, I had done some, I'd done the variety shows and game shows, you know, those kinds of things. But I that wasn't in my future for me, but I came out and I'd come out a few times before, done some interviews and then just gone right back to New York. But then I came out this one time, and within a week, I got a series. So, you know, I took it. And, you know, it made a big difference in my life. But I always thought we'd probably move back to New York, but we didn't. My husband got busy directing television, and, you know, here we are. And we went back a lot because I had an apartment there. But then they kicked us out of my apartment because we weren't there long enough every year. The lawyers took me to court for 2-3 years.
That's always fun.
That really pissed me off. I thought there should be a law against this.
But I want to go back. I want to start, you know, you were born in Pensacola. Your father was in the Navy. My father was too.
So, oh, yes?
Yes, my father was in the Navy. And I'm a skipper, so there's all that connection there. So,
oh, God.
But, from what I understand, the bug, for lack of a better term, did not really bite you until you joined a choir years later when you were in high school, and that was in Virginia. What changed?
You know, I wasn't even aware of this. I mean, I had no ambitions whatever to be on stage, the movies. Movies were, of course, where I totally lose myself, and I loved it. Because when my dad was at sea, you'll appreciate this, when he went to sea, and he was gone for years at a time sometime, we would go live with my grandmother. My mother and my sister and I would go live with my grandmother in Mount Carmel, Illinois. So my grandmother took me to all the musical movies. Her favorite was Betty Grable. I saw all them. And my uncle took me to all the cowboy movies. And my mother took, you know, so I was lost in that world. But no thoughts or ambitions about anything. But I was told much later that I sang all the time. And I used, and my aunt, who was a music teacher, said, you made up songs all the time. So when I got in high school, I went to a big high school, Washington Lee High School in Alexandria, and they were renowned for their choir. So I kind of arbitrarily, because I wanted to get out of typing class, went and auditioned, and I got in. And it did. It changed my life. The woman, the choir teacher, changed my life. I got out of typing class, and this choir toured. So it was quite a thing. And then she kept putting me in smaller groups and doing everything. And then maybe you know this, one day she said, I'd like to come talk to your family. So she took me home and sat everybody down and said, do you know Nancy sings? And she really sings. And if you can afford it, I'd like to recommend a singing teacher and blah, blah, blah. So, I mean, my parents were stunned.
Stunned. And also, the business as any family could possibly be.
Yeah, it freaked my dad out, frankly. But they did find a teacher. I was studying ballet in Washington, and they found a singing teacher. And then I started singing with the band, and I started doing a local television show. And I was in love with Jane Froman at that time.
Wow, yes.
So my big song was, I Believe. But my parents wouldn't let me continue because I had to join the union. And that is too bad because, you know, I had to pick my own songs and do that kind of thing. So I'm sorry they didn't let me continue. Meanwhile, back to the choir teacher, Florence Booker, she said, Are you going to go to college and you're going to study music? And I went, well, I got accepted by Duke University. She went, oh, no. No. And this was like in March before September school. She said, no, I'm calling Northwestern where I went. And she literally picked up the phone and called the music school and said, take her.
And they did.
And they did. I didn't have to audition. I didn't have to take a test. I didn't have to write a letter because, you know, now, because I've taught a lot of young people, what they have to go through to get in school is madness, just with all the things they have to write and prepare and musically prepare. So.
Was it at Northwestern that you started to act as well?
Yes. Yeah. I was very happy in the music school doing, and I had a fantastic teacher who entered me in every contest in Chicago. So I won a contest. I sang Carmen excerpts with the Chicago Symphony. Oh God, I wish there was a tape of that. I weighed about 95 pounds. I played the castanets. I did the whole bit.
Well, something else happened while you were there. You ended up in Life magazine. So.
I did. Miss Student Body.
Miss Student Body. How did that come about?
Well, they do a huge, huge musical show every year called the WAMU Show. And I got in every year. I mean, it was a really big deal. I was dating my first husband at the time, and he said, I'd like to come. I said, I can't get you a ticket, but I finally did. But anyway, that was one of the numbers. Warren Beatty was in the number. I had dated him in high school. That was the other thing about high school. Oh, God, that was a good time. And then Life magazine came in. We almost were all going to be on the cover, but something else interrupted that. But that was a really big deal to be in Life magazine. Good God.
I searched and I searched and I searched for that Life magazine, and I couldn't find it. But I did.
I have.
What was that?
I have it.
I'm sure you do. But you, not too long after that, look at you. You appeared in Life magazine yet again.
Yes.
This I was able to find. Because I actually have this one.
Yeah.
Yes.
That also was a really big deal. That was at the upstairs or the downstairs fights back or what downstairs, whatever it was called.
Downstairs.
That was really life changing. I auditioned for Julius Monk. Do you know anything about Julius Monk?
Yeah, I do, of course. Absolutely.
Yeah. I don't know who dragged me in there.
One of my dearest friends.
Oh.
Yes.
But anyway, I sang for him in the kitchen. He just dragged me into the kitchen. He said, well, let me hear you. I knew he was putting together a new review. I think it was because of my pianist who had worked there. So I don't know what I sang for him in the kitchen. And then I filled in for about a week before the review actually started. I was talking about it the other day with someone. I don't have a clue what I sang. I don't know what I would have put together. But and I was really jealous of everyone else in the show because I thought they were so talented. George Firth was in it. A woman named Jenny Lou Law, who was Julie's favorite at the time, and I was very envious of her. And so I was actually embarrassed when the reviews came out because they were so fantastic. And then I got in Life magazine. Julius was very happy. So when I asked to get out to do the Fantastics, he said no. So I had to turn down the Fantastics.
Well, now that you mentioned the Fantastics, Tom Jones is going to be on the show on Sunday afternoon. So everyone who's watching, please tune in Sunday afternoon and join Tom Jones and myself.
Yeah, he won't remember that. He won't, you know, because they kept calling and asking, and are you available? We really think we want you, and blah, blah. And, you know, I finally had to say no, but I called them. I called the office like three times to tell them about anybody I knew about. Because, you know, at that point in New York, you auditioned for a new show actually in the theater on a stage.
That's right.
Oh my God. And so I kind of knew who was good. So I called and I said, the only one I can recommend is Rita Gardner. I said, she's always better than everybody else. Always.
Wonderful.
So I told her that once. I said, I don't think that got you the job. I think by that time they probably knew that. But
well, Nancy, let me ask you, when you were at Northwestern and you are, there's one thing to be in the throes of everything. It's a whole different ball of wax when you say, I'm going to really pursue this as a career. What was the defining moment for you where you decided that you wanted to pursue this as a career? And I always say there's a fork in every artist's life. Whether it's the East Coast or the West Coast. Obviously, if you want to do live theater and performance, that leads to New York.
Yeah.
How did that all happen for you?
Well, my best friend at the time, a singer at Northwestern who was fantastic, her name at that time was Henrietta Embick. It later was Henrietta Valor. I don't know if you ever heard her name. She sang crazy great. She, after the freshman year, did Summer Stock. And came back talking about it. And it kind of proved to be a negative for her because she was one of those people who sang from the time she was 2 years old. And everyone, she just knew she was going to have a career. But I think she was stunned when she saw all those other talented people. And I went, well, golly, if she can do that, you know, maybe I can. So I auditioned and got in. The whole chorus almost at that time was from Northwestern. Most of the singers were from Northwestern. Ron Huseman was in the chorus. You know, and we started, South Pacific was the first show. We did seven shows a season, and I'm trying to remember the musical, Cole Porter, and Bill Hayes was the star, and Out of This World, that was the show. And I had my first part, and it was opposite Bill, and I was so excited. And then we did some, and Bill at that time was from Chicago, so we started doing radio shows and everything. And one of the interviewers asked him, he said, you know, Nancy now says she wants to go to New York, because that kind of was the turning point. And it was that cliche, I can do this, I can do this. And that was huge, because I'd never, like I said, I'd really never thought about it. I took this job kind of as a lark. And so Bill said, oh, I think she'll do very well. He said, I think within 5 years she'll, and I went, 5 years? Good God.
You know, that seems like a lifetime at that time.
That seemed like a lifetime to me. I still talk to him. I just talked to him the other day, Bill Hayes.
Oh, send him our love. I mean,
he was so great and helpful to me and Ron and everybody. I mean, he was terrific. So that was the real crowning moment when I thought, oh my gosh, I really want to do that. So I started always doing summer stock, and I was underage. I was 16, 17. So the stage manager, my nickname was JB, Jailbait, because he was always pulling me off some guy's lap, or, you know, if we had parties, he was always dragging me out of the room. You have to go home now, kid. Because I was really, really naive. So I didn't even wait for the graduation ceremony. I went right onto my next job. I had a job at the Cohasset Summer Theater. And we were doing Can Can, and I had a little part.
Was that the show, or was it Out of This World that you got your equity card?
I immediately got my equity card just joining that company. That's how easy it was. I got a professional job, you know, so I got it. I don't know what all it takes. A lot more now.
You came to New York essentially with your equity card already in.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah. So off I went to Cohasset, where I don't know how long into the rehearsal. And it was a theater in the round. And tearing down that aisle, the girl in front of me tripped. And she tripped and kind of fell off to the right, but I fell. And everyone fell on me. And I really hurt myself, but I didn't know it at the time. And I got up. And, I mean, we're doing can-can, for heaven's sake. And it finally got so painful, and I couldn't sit down. I couldn't do anything. So the man I was dating drove up to see me, and he had to rent a station wagon because I couldn't sit. He laid me down, took me to a specialist, and I'll never forget it. He did two little tests on me, and he said, "Oh, my darling, you have to go home. You have to go home. You've cracked your spine. You've got discs. Oh. You've got discs out of whack." The theater built a special wooden seat that would fit in the plane seat that would keep me kind of in the right, you know, place. And home I went, sobbing. I mean, you know, I was 19. I thought I was so charged up because after that summer, boy, I was, you know, going into New York. And thank God that was a period where they didn't do much about backs at that point. My dad took me to a specialist at home, the Naval Hospital. And he said, "You're so young. We want to leave you alone. If you have a place like with your folks," he said, "just go lie down." So they dragged a mattress. They put it on the floor in front of the TV in the living room. And I was there for about 10 months.
Wow.
On the floor.
I have to ask you, how, you know, it was interesting in 1983, and I had been in New York I came to New York in 79. But in 1983, while I was doing summer stock, I ate a tainted shrimp and I got deathly ill from it. I almost died. And I went back to South Carolina to recuperate where I'm from. And it took me almost 9 months to recuperate. And
wow.
And then when I was well enough I ended up auditioning for a show there. I did the show. And the day after the show closed, I was back on my way to New York City because I missed it so much. I wanted to be back. How long did it take you to get to New York?
Well, I got up slowly.
That's your agent calling, by the way.
Yes. Oh, he never calls.
He's calling.
Oh, that's another story. I started doing therapy, swimming, and they put me in this hideous brace. And I asked the doctor, I said, "Are you doing this because I really have to be that still and then or because I move too fast?" He said, "You move too fast." So I wore a brace for a little bit. I went back to Northwestern for about a month and worked with my singing teacher and then arrived in New York in the middle of winter on just a terrible day and moved in with two friends from school, the three of us in a studio apartment. I paid $35 a month. And I was so happy. And I actually started working quite quickly. I took a opera workshop class with the former conductor of the Chicago Symphony. And then my roommate was a model at that time in New York. So she dragged me to her office one day with her, and I was reading the showbiz papers sitting in the outer room. And she said, "Come meet my agents." And so I went in, and they were really darling. And they said, "What you doing these days?" I said, "Nothing, but I just found out about an audition." I said, "I don't have an agent." And he said, "Give it to me. I'll call." So they called and got me an audition for The Boyfriend that had just opened off Broadway.
Wow.
Gus Shermer. Did you ever know Gus Shermer?
Yes.
So they called. I got an audition and I sang, "It's Never Too Late." Yeah. "It's Never Too Late to Fall in Love." That one. I did it slow as a ballad and then I did it as fast as you can imagine, dancing at the same time, and got the job. So I I went on tour with it. And that was, and I'd already done a few little weird jobs off Broadway, none of which were any good. But that was really fun. When I got back, I got married right away. And then because of Gus Schirmer, I got another off Broadway job called Diversions for 5+1. And again, just got I got crazy good reviews. And from that, I got an agent and got, you know, then it really started. So that was fun. Steve Venever wrote the review. Carl Davis and Stephen Venever. Do you remember Stephen's name? He wrote the Mad Show.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, yeah.
But Nancy, you know, we joke about agents and managers. Did you begin putting a team together for yourself, or was it just
should have? When I look back, I thought, man, I didn't know how to do anything. I had a very top. Oh gosh, my thing just went cockeyed. No, I'll probably be cockeyed the rest of the time.
No,
I had a manager, business manager, and an agent. But you know, after I got Do-Re-Mi, I mean, right away I was on the Ed Sullivan Show and all these shows. But it never occurred to me to God, I need to find a pianist and work on stuff all the time so that I'm ready for, you know.
Well, I want to go back for a moment. I think, if I'm not mistaken, your Broadway debut was Stepping into the Sound of Music.
No, Do-Re-Mi.
No, Do-Re-Mi, and then Sound of Music came later.
Yeah, that was the second. That was my second one. Yeah.
So, what I mean, at that time also, we had shows like the Ed Sullivan Show, and I'm building up for a setup. So we had shows like the Ed Sullivan Show and everything. What was that experience like to go on that show, which was live when it was done? And did you feel as if you were being shot out of a cannon?
Oh, yeah. Tammy Grimes was supposed to have done it. I think it was New Year's Eve or New Year's Day or something. And we had just opened mid-December, so they got me, and Jule Styne was playing the piano. I had no clothes. They bought me clothes, the Ed Sullivan Show. They bought me a beautiful outfit just to stand there as they introduced me. They had to take in everything like crazy, and I still have the dress that I sang Make Someone Happy in. I still have it. And I look at it, it's so teeny tiny. And Julie at the piano, and it was just madness backstage. I mean, of course, they couldn't cut my number or do any mess with it. Like, they were always saying, cut out 8 bars, or, you know, comics were always having to cut out material. The stage managers were both crazy nervous. I mean, I'd never been involved with anything that kind of, it was hysterical a little bit.
How did the heart change? You know, was it like an overnight change? Did you feel in your own self? I mean, does that build your confidence that you got through something like that? How did your life change?
You know, it didn't change a whole lot, really, because I think I was stunned most of the time. Or, you know, because of Phil Silvers and everybody in the show and Nancy Walker. I mean, Phil knew everybody. It was always Leonard Bernstein was coming around, and hi, Nancy. And was that Lena Horne you were playing before I got on the?
It was before.
I'm just digressing now. Betty Comden always had a New Year's Day party, so I got invited to that. And my husband came, and I think his parents were with us, and Lena Horne was there.
Wow.
She was so beautiful that none of us could talk. I mean, she was all in white. She had a beautiful white dress on. And she was sitting across the room talking to Henry Fonda. I mean, this was magic to me, all this. She came over, got an ottoman and swirled it around and sat and faced me and said, oh, honey, you're just the best. You are the cutest thing. You are just great. I mean, and I'm sure my husband and I both were just, we couldn't talk. I don't think I said anything. All those years go by, and I go to see her do her one-woman show, and I don't remember the year that was. Do you remember where the big show she did in New York?
She did The Lady and Her Music. That was 1984, yeah. I think it was.
Well, my husband took me for my birthday.
If I'm wrong, but I think
I was taken for my birthday. And it was interesting because someone else had taken me years before to see her in a club. And she was, of course, wonderful and gorgeous, but not very talkative or overly warm, you know, to the audience. Mm-hmm. So here she is. I mean, the dress is loose and flowing. And I mean, she's really in her element. At one point she said, "And today is my birthday." And I stood up in the audience and said, "Me too." And my husband, "Sit down."
Good for you.
I was so flattered. I mean, you know, I thought, oh my God, I'm in such good company. Lena Horne. So yeah, she was something. Now getting back to your initial queries about did it change my life? Not really. I was thrilled with it and knew that it was kind of exceptional. But I really was very busy doing this show, and they sent me out. I was the one with David Burns. We did all the publicity. We were the ones that went to every luncheon, everything. And I quite enjoyed that. And the other fun thing for me was the dresser. Nancy Walker's dresser was also a dressmaker. So she made all my clothes for all these occasions. And I knew this was not normal. I mean, a normal life, you know. But I was so taken with the show and having such a good time. And I won, I'm trying to remember which award it was, if it was a Theater World Award or a Q Magazine Award, something. But Richard Burton gave us, the group, the award. So, and he was across the street, right across the street from us in Camelot, of course. So when the ceremony was over, he came up to me, and he was one of those, like Warren Beatty, they stand this close to you and talk to you. And you are the only person.
You got to look into those gorgeous blue eyes.
And he, "Oh, my darling, you were my wife." He said my wife. He mentioned his wife. "Saw you in the show, and you're so absolutely delicious," and blah, blah, blah. And he said, "May I take you to dinner before the show?" And I pointed off to the right, and I said, "Can he come?" And he said, "Who?" And I said, "My husband." And he started laughing. He just started laughing, and he said, "Yes. Oh, my dear, yes, he can come." So it ended up there were probably 6-7 of us all went to dinner, and he regaled us the whole time with stories. Walked me back to my stage door holding my hand, gave me a big kiss, said goodbye, see ya, and I never saw him again. But I talk about floating into the theater. Richard Burton just kissed me because everybody was so smitten with him. Oh, my God, including myself. So, I mean, yeah, I guess my life, of course, did change.
I didn't feel like I was special.
I didn't feel special or anything like that. You know, I went on with my life and working hard. But the one thing, this shows how naive I am. I didn't want to go on tour. And, you know, David Merrick went, "See this contract?" And then they asked me to go to London to do the show. And I never mentioned it to my husband. I just said, "Oh, I can't. I'm married." Time goes by, I mention it to my husband, and he said, "Of course we could have gone." He worked for an international company. "Of course we could have gone." And that I regret. I'm really sorry.
Well, you know, it's funny when you said earlier, you know, if I knew then what I know now, and that's, you know, that's the age old thing, you know, George Bernard Shaw said, youth is wasted on the young. You know, if the things that we learn as we go through life, and we've all had those moments where you don't want to rock the boat, obviously, so you don't say anything to your husband. And there are all these, I look at them as forks in the road, or I call them It's a Wonderful Life moments. What if I had made this choice instead of this choice? Was there a particular point in your career when people started saying, "See if you can get us Nancy Dussault, or also a Nancy Dussault type"?
I don't know. Not to my knowledge. I never was aware of that, if that ever was going on. It's It's interesting. The only time, you know, this is totally different from what you just asked.
Okay.
I was just thinking, you know, I did that. I did Sound of Music, and that was great. I had a ball doing that because it was such a repeat audience. I mean, people came all the time, and I it turned out to be such a blessing for like the rest of my life, because I still meet people who say, I saw you in Sound of Music and blah, blah, blah. My mother took me when I was 6 or 8 or whatever. I thought I'd love to be in another show that appeals to families and kids, because they never forget you. Mm-hmm. They just never forget that experience. What was the first show you saw?
The first show that I saw on Broadway?
No, just as a musical. What was the first show you ever saw?
Well, it was, I mean, the first show that I saw when I was a kid, Treasure Island, a touring company came through my hometown, and I went to see it. I also went, believe it or not, with my parents to see Minnie Pearl.
Oh, I loved her.
And I saw her, and the moment she came out, I said, I want to do that, because everyone was laughing at everything she said. That was it for me. I knew that, but I grew up on 1960s and 70s television and variety shows and everything.
Oh, yeah.
That was the world that I wanted to be a part of. And you did a lot of variety shows. Were these things that you pursued, or did they pursue you?
They pursued me. Yeah. Because doing the Telephone Hour and all those kind of shows was fantastic. And I think it's so sad today. No, these younger people don't have a chance to do all these wonderful shows. You know, Gary Moore and Carol Burnett and God, there were, but what made me laugh when I finally got to do Too Close for Comfort, and I did some specials with Dinah Shore and Burt Reynolds and specials. And I remember crying in the kitchen one night. I go, I finally am on a hit show on television, and there are no more variety shows.
I know.
That era had passed, and you know, when I talked to you about what your first show was, I remembered that my first experience going to the theater, we were living in Coronado. My dad was at the air station there, mm-hmm. and my mother was taking me to a matinee in San Diego of the Desert Song. And again, when the orchestra started, everything started, I stood up and started walking down the aisle. You know, my mother put me down in my seat. I mean, that just, it was magical, like your experience. All these years go by, I'm getting ready to work at the Sacramento Music Theater.
Mm.
A man picks me up at the airport, and I'm in a really bad mood. And I thankfully don't even remember why. But I really wasn't very talkative, and I was staring out the window as he was driving me into my hotel. And we started talking about some shows, and he asked me, what was the first show you ever saw? And I said, The Desert Song. He said, oh, yes, I produced it. Well, from then on, we were close friends. I thought, isn't this great? Which is, of course, as we all know, one of the wonderful things about this business. The people that you encounter and hopefully recounter again, and you know, that circle of people. I always wish I'd stayed in touch, or was much better about staying in touch with a lot of the people I worked with over the years. I just always assumed I would see them again or work with them again. And of course that doesn't always happen.
Well, I want to ask you, I mean, you've been asked over and over and over again about Too Close for Comfort, but I want to talk about something else. And I want to talk
Good.
About this young gentleman that you're pictured with here, David
yep.
Hartman.
And?
I want to read you something, if I may. I got a note from David to read to you.
You did?
Yes. He said, Nancy could not have been a more perfect host. Well, I'm going to go back. I just accessed your message. Terrific to honor Nancy. I am disappointed that not only is my laptop busted, not that I know how to use it anyway, but my family of children and grandchildren have arrived over the weekend for a long planned visit to be with Gramps Dave. We are overwhelmed with housefuls of big and little people doing overdue fam celebrations, so cannot do video with you tomorrow. That said, perhaps maybe you could somehow incorporate the following into your program with Nancy. Nancy could not have been a more perfect first co-host of GMA. Those days were challenging for all of us to try to create a new morning news and information program with all of us learning new skills daily. Nancy was and is one of the most talented leading ladies of Broadway, super singer and actress who transferred her talents, warmth, charm, and unpretentiousness to our joint efforts. She was a wonderful partner, and her personal self was a delight for morning television. She and I had been acquainted more than a decade earlier when she was already a Broadway star as I was looking for work. I was very disappointed when the network replaced her in her co-host spot, as I recall, less than a year into our start in November 1975. Naturally, she continued on in her wonderful work in theater and TV, the fabulous professional, so disciplined and talented. Please give her my warmest regards and huge hugs, along with my huge disappointment that I cannot share this time with her live online. And best to you, Richard, and everyone for always honoring Nancy Dussault. Today, David Hartman.
Oh, wow.
Yes.
Well, that is really lovely.
Yes.
Can you send me a copy of that?
I'll send you a copy of it. Yes. But he wanted to be here tonight, and I got that this morning, and he was so disappointed that he couldn't be here.
You know, I wish we had copies. I mean, it really, he's right. It was an onslaught of trying to figure everything out doing that show. And I think I was hired within 2 weeks of starting. I kept getting phone calls from some guy, and finally I returned the call. I didn't answer right away because I thought he was going to ask me to do another benefit. But it was calling from ABC to see if I'd be interested in doing this show. So I did come in, and because I knew David already, I'm sure that was so helpful in getting the job. So he interviewed me. I talked to him. They had me do commercials. They had me try, you know, all kinds of things. And I was hired. And they had a very small staff at the beginning. They tried to start live right away, but really, they just couldn't finesse it. So we, you know, boom, we're on the air. I mean, there were days when even David and I would do a commercial together where we started laughing so hard we couldn't, they just cut.
Yeah.
We couldn't finish. And then they had me do the weather a couple of times because the weatherman from Chicago was in negotiations with his contract. Well, I had no setup whatsoever for doing the weather. So I had the information, of course, on the prompter. And I mean, that turned into a comedy routine, which the head of ABC loved because that's why he wanted me on the show. In South Dakota, you know, I'd be like, wherever.
I've done it. It's the hardest thing in the world.
Oh, yes.
That green screen. I was doing something and I went, it's 69 degrees in Poughkeepsie. And
yes.
Perch, who was the weather girl, came and moved my hand. And I said, they moved Poughkeepsie?
And then they came up one morning, you know, this is 5 a.m. or whatever. Can you write all the showbiz stuff? And I went, I don't write. You know, he said, well, yeah, you will. Here's a typewriter. And they gave me some information. And so, you know, I madly try. I mean, it was crazy. And the thing was, and this is a huge lesson that I learned at that time, but a little too late. I kept thinking I could figure it all out by myself. I think only twice did I go to the producer and complain, because they literally would do this. They'd go interview them. About what? No producer with me, nobody, just a cameraman and me. So couple of times when they edited the pieces together, I went, Jesus, that's so boring. I talked to the man for 4 hours. you know, and someone said, well, you go to editing, don't you? And I went, no, I didn't have a lot of time to do that because they sent me out a lot.
What time did you have to be in the studio each day?
5.
Wow.
Or 5:30. You know, the show went on live at 7. I probably got there at 5:30.
Complete opposite of the theater world life.
Oh, it was so hard. But what my point about this was, I could have asked anybody for help. I mean, Barbara Walters was on the show every now and then. I could have, and she was darling to me. I could have called her at any time and said, Jesus, help me out here. I don't know what I'm doing. I knew I had the right attitude in the show, and I really did do my homework. And interestingly enough, because I lived in New York, I was a little more hip to everything than David was. But David had a huge advantage, and he did something I should have. His wife had been a producer and stuff in television. So every single day for a while after the show, he called her, and they went through the entire show. I was afraid to look at it. I thought I would be such a critic of every move I made that it would hamper me. But that was a mistake, you know, and I could have gotten more help and been better.
No, so you're saying that he went and watched the show after it was already filmed and everything.
I don't know if they went through the whole 2 hours, but I know he was in there doing that. You know, and we, years later, when I went back just to visit all my chums in the office, you know, somebody was saying, oh, David, he's such a smart ass now, and he has his own research person. And I went, good heavens, what's the matter with that? Because I never got enough research because we didn't have enough writers. You know, so, but it was a telling experience. I mean, gosh, the people I met and people that I didn't think I liked, you know, that a lot of people I had to interview, it really helped me not prejudge people. Because some people, you know, that I really thought, oh, I never liked him. I don't respect him. I don't, you know, they come in, hi, Nancy, how are you? And blah, blah, blah. And I'd go, well, he's not that bad, you know. But I did. I just got to meet everybody. And this made me love David. One morning, Carl Sagan was the guest. And he was so big at that time. And he had a show. And David asked him a technical kind of question about space and everything. And I was standing right behind the camera that was on David because I really wanted to hear everything. I was a big Carl fan. And he gave his answer. And there was a silence. And David said, I'm going to ask you the question all over again. I didn't understand one thing you said, which I really applauded David for doing that. And Carl Sagan laughed. And he went, okay, let's do this again. Let me see if I can, you know, be more clear. And off they went. But, you know, we got criticized because we were not news people, but it was not under the news division.
No.
It was under entertainment, and we both worked real hard, you know. But the hours, like you commented on, if friends invited me to dinner, I said it has to be at 5:30 or 6. And I there was especially one couple that I knew quite well that I would go to their house the most often, and I almost always fell asleep about 7:30. I just couldn't. It was so hard on my body and my psyche. And when the show sent me to see Michelle Baryshnikov at Lincoln Center, and I was so thrilled that I got a ticket and I got in, and I started to cry. I mean, I just thought, oh my God, I'm seeing one of the greatest dancers in the world. And I can barely stay awake. And I wasn't there long enough. I was there 2 years to really get into the swing of the hours. Cause like you said, my life was so different, but it was a great time for me.
Well, with everything that happens in a career, there are you get into a routine. And if there was any particular moment in your career that if you could go back for a day and relive it, is there any particular moment that you would just love to go back just once more and relive again?
Golly. That's quite a question. I don't think so. I really, it would take me a day or two to think about that. Mm-hmm. Isn't that funny? I think is one of the most fun times in the business I ever had was, when I really think about it all, was opening night of Do Re Mi. Phil Silvers was so great to me. He taught me so much. And my opening number, you know, he was the guy who discovered me at a coffee shop or donut shop, whatever it was. And he was so sweet. And he would pull a chair around, and it was right on the lip downstage. And he turned so his back was to the audience looking at me on opening night. And he just gave me such a smile and a wink, and he let him have it, kid. Let him have it. You know, he was that kind of
generous
with me. And, you know, the place went crazy. I mean, that was such an introduction to Broadway and the business, because it had like seven, I'd have to count again. I'm going to say seven of the best character actors in the business.
Absolutely.
And that was a real learning lesson for me, because I would watch these guys who only had a few scenes go off and perfect every moment, word, movement of their bits on stage. I thought, oh, wow, you know, look at that. Look at it. Because I just kind of always did it. I always just kind of did it. I mean, I learned what they wanted me to learn and staging and everything. But I think I really totally relied more on instinct. And, you know, years later, I worked with Alfred Drake. We were doing a new musical together. And they said he needs always an hour early before we all start our rehearsal. Because he was the same way. Every word, every note, everything. Are you all right? Do you have your favorite drink nearby?
I swallowed air.
Uh-oh.
I got excited about Phil Silvers. Sorry, keep going. I'm sorry.
I just loved him. And he was crazy. He and Jule Styne were so funny, because they gambled. They were big gamblers. I'd see Julie running backstage every night and going to Phil's dressing room and then blabbing away. I mean, it was such a scene with all the people. And John Kennedy was coming one night, and I looked out one, because I was so far downstage singing, you know, Ingrid Bergman was sitting there. And I mean, but I thought that was normal. Until as the years went on, I went, no, none of that was normal. This was an exceptional situation, because people really loved Phil. He knew everybody. I mean, everybody came, you know, so it really was a revelation to me.
Well, I want to mention some names, and I just want the first thing that pops into your head when I mention their names. Pat Carroll.
Loved her.
I just loved her so much. And Audrey Meadows.
I liked Audrey. You know, at first, that was a kind of woman in the way she, her life and all dolled up and unfortunately smoking all the time. Mm. But she was on enough that I got to know her better. And I really loved her, because she and Pat, both of them as women and people, as a person, were very straightforward and honest and what they liked, didn't like, and how they worked. And she was okay. Pat, I loved. She was just this really down-to-earth, hearty, honest. And in all her performing, it was all right there. And I loved it.
Too Close for Comfort, this incredible ensemble. That's what I love so much about these shows that have such an ensemble cast. Do you go back and ever watch these episodes? They're on still. I still watch.
We don't get any of those channels where it's on all the time, but I have most of them. And I still see Jimmy Bullock and Lydia and Deborah. I mean, we're still together.
A family.
Which I think is quite remarkable. I mean, there have been periods of time, and Jim Bullock in particular, because I was so crazy about him, where I would just pursue him as a friend. You're not getting out of my life. You know, I really care about you. And Deborah was up here a couple of months ago, you know, so Lydia called kind of out of the blue, and she and her partner came, you know, we all met for lunch and stuff. So it's good. And it's been so interesting to see how we all have changed and adapted and, you know, gotten on with our lives.
someone else who wanted to be here tonight, but unfortunately was not able to be here, was Karen Morrow. So, yes. So, I mean, what a great long friendship the two of you have had.
Oh, I know. I know. And that was, again, I don't know what the results would have been. But, you know, when we did our concerts together and appearances together, it was a very unique thing. Two women had never done this. And I don't know what all she told you about it. We would put together these evenings so fast. We'd get together with a bottle of champagne and the big yellow pads of paper and, you know, get our act down. And did she ever tell you how we found our pianist? Did she ever tell you that story?
No.
We were in Joe Allen's. We had lunch and we were talking about it and we had a concert in a week and we didn't have a pianist. And my friend Sheila Ray said, well, there's a wonderful guy I've heard of named Bill Schneider, and he lives somewhere near Joe Allen's. He's on that street. So this was like 3 p.m. We'd been sitting there a long time. I said to Karen, I'm going outside. And there was hardly any traffic. I went outside, stood in the middle of the street and yelled his name. And then Karen, and then Karen came out and yelled his name. And from the fifth floor, window opened. And this guy with the long hair that kept falling out the window. Yes.
Rapunzel.
So we screamed out all our credits and told him, you know, he said, I don't really do the show tunes. He said, oh, come on up. And we had some of our music with us. So we went on up and he said, I don't know this song. It was Sound of Music or something. As he's playing like a maniac. So he said, sure, I'll do it. And then he said, by the way, would you like a cello player? My friend here is leaving to go to Europe. He said, so we said, yeah, bring the cello player. And we had a ball. He was, and still is, fantastic. So we did two of those evenings at Town Hall. And then we came out here and did our act. And then we were hired by CBS Cable to do some shows. And both of us had managers at the time. And they went, isn't this cute? Not one of them thought, maybe we should call Columbia and book them, book them places like the Callaways or something. I mean, it was, and when we sang here in LA, I can't tell you who came. Everybody came. Big movie stars and stuff. I mean, we were really having a good time.
Nancy, you and Karen should come to New York and do 54 Below one night and the place will be packed. With a line all the way to Joe Allen.
It probably would. I mean, when we listen, and I listened to some of our singing at that time, I went, oh my God. Because we were both in primo voice. We were we couldn't have been singing better, both of us. Voices so big and full and beautiful. I mean, Karen, they always say the belter, but Karen's belt voice, if you want to call it that, has always been a beautiful sound. It hasn't been that, which everybody sounds like. Everyone kind of sounds alike to me now. Both of our voices, I thought, were very unique and beautiful, really beautiful. And we had a ball. And we were very creative. And I don't know if we would ever do it again. My voice ain't so hot right now. And she doesn't want to sing anymore. She doesn't want to get dressed later at night.
But you're
right. I think if we did.
Nancy, I could go on forever with you, but I want to spend your time.
I'm crazy about you.
Thank you so much for doing this with me today.
Everyone
who's watching. I'm going to give my closing remarks, and then I'm going to let you give your closing remarks, and we're going to close with two clips that I pulled. So first of all, I want to thank, and when you speak, it could be about anything that we spoke about that you want to build upon. Anything that we didn't speak about that you wish we had, or just any final message that you want to leave everyone with. And when you say goodbye,
my husband's just arriving.
That's fine. Okay. We're going to get there quickly, but I want to thank you. Put your phone on camera.
Hang on 1 second. Come here. I won't be able to stop him.
No, bring him on camera.
Come here. Wait, you're going to be on camera. Come here. Hey, I can't get it.
No, he's camera shy. But...
No, he sees Val. He's That's going
fine.
Crazy.
That's fine. My dog does the same thing. I want to thank everybody for being here today. I know that I can speak for Nancy when I say this. When you spend an hour or more with us, we don't take it lightly. So thank you for all being here today. I hope you enjoyed today's show. And please, I mean, there are clips on YouTube. There's so much out there. Go and enjoy it. I found a phenomenal episode of you with Carol Burnett and Dick Van Dyke on the Carol Burnett Show this afternoon. Oh. And it was so much fun to watch it. Have you seen it?
No.
I'll send it to you. Anyway, everyone, I always end every show by telling everyone to go out and do something nice for somebody else without expecting anything in return. Pick up the phone. Nancy, I want you to do the same thing. Pick up the phone and call someone you have not spoken okay. to in a long time. An email message, not a text message.
No, I'm not.
An inbox message, a phone call. And let that person know how they've made a difference in your life. And trust me, you'll make a difference in their life. I have a dear friend. He says, we're all in the same storm, but we're in different size boats. And I always say, I don't care what size boat you're on, as long as you have a skipper by your side. And with that, Nancy, I'm turning it over to you. And thanks, everyone, for being here.
This has been an absolute joy to be with you, Richard. And you asked some wonderful, really thoughtful questions that made me able to think about my journey in the business and in my life, and what did make a difference and what didn't make a difference. And I'll kind of close with, when I talked about, if you need help, ask for help. When I first started doing my act, I started asking people for help. I needed advice. I wanted a special song. Billy Barnes wrote me a special song. I needed help. So I have been trying to do that with people I've met in the business and offering whatever advice I can and help I can. In the business or not, as Richard said, be good to somebody, everybody. Call somebody, tell them how wonderful they are, how special they are. This has been a joy, Richard. Let's do it again. Can we do it again? I hope so. Bye-bye.
Now, Nancy Dussault, the Sound of Music, and her Sound of Music youngsters open this section with the delightful Do, Re, Mi.
Start at the very beginning, a very good place to start. When you read, you begin with, when you sing, you begin with Do, Re, Mi.
Do, Re, Mi.
Do, Re, Mi. The first three notes just happen to be Do, Re, Mi.
Do, Re, Mi.
Do, Re, Mi, Fa, Sol. Oh, come. I'll make it easier for you. Listen. Doe, a deer, a female deer. Ray, a drop of golden sun. Me, a name I call myself. Far, a long, long way to run. So, a needle pulling thread. La, a note to follow. So, tea, a drink with jam and bread. That will bring us back to Do. Oh, oh, oh.
Do, a deer, a female deer. Ray, a drop of golden sun. Me, a name I call myself. But a long, long way to run. So, a needle pulling thread. Love, love. Tea, a drink with jam and bread. That will bring us back to Do.
re. Do.
Yeah!
Love is everywhere under the sun, unrequited or returned. Seems like everyone joins in the fun. Some get happiness, some get burned. It doesn't seem quite fair with all this love around me. I know I've got the wherewithal, yet love has never found me. Love, here I am, unabashed, unattached, unafraid, eager for my first mistake to be meet my first one. Love, are you blind? Here am I, open-armed, open-minded. Though it may be unique to you, look at me, love. When I speak to you, try to be nice, love. Here I am. To me.